Sir Thomas Beecham, in his own words.
For the first 6 years of my life, I took no interest in music or art or anything of that sort. But I was a model child. I hardly ever spoke. I was the joy of my father and the worry of my dear mother. But when I was six, I was taken to a concert and I heard some music, Grieg on the piano. And when I got home, I couldn't forget the music. And I got up, out of bed, went downstairs, walked into the drawing room, about a dozen people, and said, I want to learn the piano. Well, that was a great shock to everyone. I was seized, I was taken back to bed, because they thought I might have become afflicted suddenly with a strange malady. But the next day, the music master of the neighborhood was called in, and I started my first lesson, which was one of five-finger exercises. Well, I went on for many years, but I didn't play much real music for the piano. I liked playing operas. And my inclination was encouraged in that, because in my father's house, there was an immense musical box called an orchestrion. And this reproduced the sound of about 50 instruments. And it played all sorts of selections from operas by Wagner and Verdi and others. And that I loved. In other words, my first real love in music was opera. Then I was sent to a public school where there was not much music. But I played the piano at public concerts. I thought rather badly. But the others thought it was not too bad. I went to Oxford and I did the same thing. And then I came to London and I took up music seriously. And after a year or two, I found myself conducting opera companies. Then after that, founding orchestras and playing music of all sorts. And that went on for years and years, right down to the present day. I have never stopped, and I don't think I ever will, unless I'm forced to. I've just been informed that I have an evil reputation for stirring the waters in the musical world and creating what I might call controversial disturbances. Well, I plead guilty to that, because I think in an easygoing country like England, which is very tolerant and good-natured, and lazy too, it is essential that from time to time somebody gives them a jolt and a jog and reminds them that the world must go on. It goes on itself, you know. You probably know the old Indian proverb that the river Ganges is never the same from one minute to another. That is to say, it flows by, and therefore is a different river. Well, the world every day is a different world, and that's always something to remember. Each morning you wake up, it is a new universe with a new atmosphere, and everyone should remember that and say, now, what can I do that's different from yesterday or last week? I must contribute something to the quantum, in fact, to the whole sum of human knowledge, human pleasure, enjoyment, and all the rest of it.
Thank you.
very beginning, I helped Kennedy Scott with the Oriara Medical Society, afterwards the London Philharmonic Choir. I brought forward the hitherto unknown new symphony orchestra. Then I formed my own orchestra. And then I proceeded, after a while, to take theatres and give scores of operas. But opera was limited to an audience, very few thousand here and there. Of course, it commanded a great deal of what I might call approval, in a way, because to give opera in countries like England and America, which were not naturally operatic, meant a good deal of prestige to those who were undertaking this production. Very, very few English musicians would confess to that I really like music. I mean, you gather from what most of them say is that music is a sideshow. It's not been a sideshow with me. It has been at least 50% of my preoccupation, so far as the public is concerned, and my general interest. I've been almost equally interested in other arts, but not quite so much as I am in music. And that's the only reason why I took it up. I really like it. I like to do it. It is an absorbing thing. And of course it's a very, very entertaining thing too. There's no end of fun to be derived from it, especially in opera house, and you're running it yourself. I was over 30 years involved, off and on, with running opera houses here and there, and hardly a day passed without some perfectly side-splitting demonstration of imbecility. I think I have told the story of a poor Chaliapin who was rehearsing the last act of Don Quixote of Massenet. And there was a trio of them. There was a basso, Sancho Panza, and then the ghost of Dulcinea, who sang from the coulisse, you know. Well, Chaliapin would never sing with the other three, and it was very untidy, and I complained. And all at once, the Dulcinea appeared from the coulisse and said to me, "Sir, I cannot. I cannot." I said, "What cannot you, madam?" "I cannot. Monsieur Chaliapin, he always died too soon." I said, "Madam, you are gravely in error. No operatic artist has ever died half soon enough for me."
I think, gentlemen, so far as I'm able to keep tag, as they say, of these proceedings, we now have to play Symphony 100. The military symphony. Now.
Ooh.
the military gentleman over there. Now, what have you got? What have you brought along with you? Give an account of yourself. What are you playing?
I play the triangle.
Triangle, what are you playing?
Simple.
What?
Simple.
Is there a side drum?
No.
Not in this piece at
no.
all? What a pity. No other percussion instruments?
No.
Very remiss of Haydn, having taken the trouble to write a military symphony, limits himself to three percussionists. Well, we must do something about it, I think, before we finish with it. Anyway, we'll hear it and see what it sounds like. Right. We've got 40 years. La 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 la. La 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 la. Right. Very gallant. Very one. Going on, you see. Worcester Cathedral, there was old Ethel, you know, in a kimono and thing, and all getting tangled up with a stick and everything. I was in the choir, and suddenly, knock, 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 resounded through the cathedral. Noise stopped, went on. Knock again. Stopped again. Somebody said, where's it coming from? Somebody pointed to the Traforian. Somebody pointed to the clerestory. And somebody then pointed to the tomb in the middle of the choir. Sort of guy in a Montfontine or something who'd been to the crusade and came back with one leg. So then a man said, oh, can't come from there. No. That tomb hasn't been open for 500 years. He's been there for over 600 years. And a voice from the orchestra said, but he wants to go out now! Now, I'm going to have a go straightway at one of the highlights in this opera. which is the song of Osmeen in the last act. And we got a piccolo. We've got to play the damn piccolo. You. Where's Mr. Jack? Oh, there he is. Fine, we'll come in later. One piccolo, two oboes, two clarinets, two bassoons, many horns, and there are. You can react. Blow into it and hear life. I've not heard him yet. I know he can play the instrument. I've no ocular evidence. He's ready? Come on, red light, come on, don't be bashful. We've seen you in different circumstances. I do mean what they think I mean.
Thank you.
to get it right, you know. There's always some meticulous, particular, pernickety bloke who'll listen to the record who'll write me angry letters. I should then have to pass it on to the horn section. Now then, if you please, the only other place is where the basso goes down with a normally low note, 1-5-2. I don't know where it, I think it's just now, just the low. Just get the pianissimo off to the accent.
Yes.
I want the accent. Now, I wonder if you could be good enough to play just on from there, on the 13th and 14th bar, as much diminuendo as you can, and the 15th bar, I think we'll have to have about half the strings until the next tempo. It's that low D, you know. Would you mind doing it after the pause so that I can see how much amount of tone we require? Just let me hear that. Up, 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 up. Not loud, please. That's a real... No accent. Auto diminuendo. Half. The Wreckers was really a success in a way. So much so that Ethel's wealthy and fashionable relations induced King Edward VII to come to one of the performances, a matinee. And His Majesty came. And he was very gracious. And he almost kissed Ethel. He certainly shook me by the hand. I don't think he actually succeeded in kissing Ethel. No man within my recollection ever has succeeded, or did succeed, in kissing Ethel. But afterwards, in fact, later on in the evening at a supper party, I asked the King's secretary what His Majesty thought about the piece. He said, I don't know what he thought about it. I said, but he must have said something. Oh, yes, he said something. It was about three quarters of the way through, and he woke up suddenly and said, Fritz, this was Fritz Bunsby, he said, that's the fourth time that infernal noise has roused me. Well, after that, my friendship, I think I can call it so, with Ethel pursued a fairly even course. But unfortunately, he was diverted from the broad course of composition into politics and revolutionary activity. This activity took the form of becoming a leader of the suffragette movement. And into that, she threw herself with the same excitement, vigor, and industry as she did into all things artistic. She led processions, she made speeches, she thumped many tubs here and there, and finally distinguished herself by throwing bricks through the dining room or drawing room windows of cabinet ministers. After a while, this was tolerated for a little while, but after a while it became too much of a habit to be encouraged. And so Ethel was, as they would say today, pinched, or in more classic English, arrested, tried and convicted, and sent to Holloway Prison to reflect and, if possible, repent. Where she neither reflected nor repented. She pursued the joyously rowdy line of activity, accompanying her were about a dozen other suffragettes, for whom Ethel wrote a stirring march song of freedom. And on one occasion, I went to see her. Well, as a matter of fact, I went to see her several times. But on this particular occasion, when I arrived, the warden of the prison, was a very amiable fellow, was
bubbling with laughter, he said, come into the quad.
Quadrangle.
There were the ladies, a dozen ladies, marching up and down, singing hard. And he pointed up to a window where Ethel appeared, was leaning out, conducting with a toothbrush. Also with immense vigor, and joining in the chorus of her own song. This was an unfortunate diversion, really, because Ethel was a composer, in a certain way, of originality. Not only of originality, but she was a composer of spirit, vigor, with a talent for emphasis, accent, or what you might vulgarly call guts. Qualities or merits that were not shared by many composers of the time in England. And in fact, some of the most spirited music of that time was written by Ethel.
I sometimes think that it might be worth living long enough to read what the historians of the future will have to say about our 20th century. What I mean is, how will they describe its main characteristics in comparison with those of the 19th, the 18th, the 17th, and so on backwards? For my part, I have little doubt that they will dub it, or at the least the greater part of it, the silly, the senseless, and the savage century. Almost from its beginning, we have lived in a state of world warfare, perhaps unprecedented in the previous history of the world. And we are still haunted by the fear of a continuation of this Saturnian epidemic of misfortune. We have also been the horrified spectators of revolutions and outbreaks of violence in several parts of the world, in which millions of innocent human beings have been massacred in cold blood by their fellow creatures. Compared with the terrible happenings of our own era, all previous public crimes during the three centuries preceding our own pale into insignificance. Some time ago, at a public gathering, I was asked for a definition of good music, and as an impromptu effort, I offered this reply. Good music is that which penetrates the ear with facility and quits the memory with difficulty. 9/10 of our so-called modern music enters the ear with extreme difficulty and quits our memories with unflattering facility. I will make no more than a passing reference to so many of the unattractive and morbidly pathological subjects which seem to have a fatal fascination for some of our composers. And it is, therefore, with a profound sense of relief that we can turn aside from this depressing sort of futility to one, at least, in whose work the qualities of beauty and grace are ever present. I refer to the composer of the opera you are about to hear tonight, Frederick Delius. This remarkable man, who 91 years ago was born in Bradford, wrote, besides dozens of works, choral and instrumental of the highest originality, 6 operas. 5 of these are great achievements, all containing scenes of the highest musical beauty, and 3 of the 5 are complete works of art, without flaw or weakness anywhere. His 4th opera, the only one with which the British public has any acquaintance, that is, A Village Romeo and Juliet, is the most consistently musical stage piece of its kind written during the last 60 years. And generally speaking, it is not too much to say that a large treasure house of genuine musical inspiration, touched by a spirit of high romance and charm, has been withheld from the public of this country by the inability of impresarios and managers to distinguish between the first rate, the second rate, and even the meretricious in art. In his dramatic works, Delia sought inspiration, not in the gutter of debased life, nor in the madhouse, but in nature, legend, and even the fairy tale.
I'm going to have a go straightway at one of the highlights in this opera, which is the song of Osmeen in the last act. Have we got a piccolo? Who's going to play the damn piccolo? You? Where's Mr. Jack? Oh, there he is. Fine, we'll come in later. One piccolo, two oboes, two clarinets, two bassoons, many horns, and there are two hands. Terrific act.
I know he can play the instrument. I've no ocular evidence. Ready? Come on, red light, come on, don't be bashful. We've seen you in different circumstances. I don't mean what they think I mean at all.
Denn nun hab ich vor euch Ruhe.
always some meticulous, particular, pernickety bloke will listen to the record and write me angry letters. I should then have to pass it on to the horn section. Now then, if you please, the only other place is where the basso goes down with an abnormally low note, 1-5-2. I don't know where it, I think it's just now, just below. Must get the pianissimo after the accent.
Yes.
I want the accent. Now, I wonder if you would be good enough to play just on from there, on the 13th and 14th bar, as much diminuendo as you can, and the 15th bar, I think we'll have to have about half the strings until the next tempo. That low D, you know. Would you mind doing it after the pause so that I can see how the amount of tone we require? Just let me hear that. Up, 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 up. Not loud, please. That's a real... No accent. Also diminuendo. Half.
Leeds was the scene of the famous scene with Jack Solomon, the trumpet player, who didn't come in, you know, in the Leonora overture. I mean, the event has become famous, but I don't think everybody knows the reason why. We were doing the Leonora number 3, you see, and then the trumpet calls were to come. Complete silence. No, one went on, finished it. After all, we made inquiries. Jack Solomon appeared, full of indignation, righteous indignation. I said, well, why weren't you playing? He said, I wasn't allowed to play.
Well, what happened?
You put me in the corridor. There I was, ready with my trumpet. I was about to blow, and two policemen came up and seized me. What are you doing here? You can't play in this corridor. There's a festival going on there. And they threw him out. All my life, when I've made gramophone records, and I've listened to the tests, I have annoyed those around me by turning up the knob so that the music is played fortissimo. Obviously, in my case, it's a necessity. I want to hear every note played. Although the effect may be distressing to the average ear, it's illuminating and edifying to mine, who am a workman in this way. I don't make records really for my own amusement. I make them to sell in the open market. So it's my duty to see that all I've striven to do with the orchestra or with singers or choruses comes off with the utmost clarity if possible. I was delighted, therefore, in seeing Sibelius last year and taking some records of mine, of his music, that he eagerly grasped them
put them on, the gramophone, and turned the knob up twice as high as I had ever done. There were about 12 or 15 people in his large sitting room. After about 3 minutes, I had the sense of vacuum, and looking round, I found the whole lot had vanished into the garden, and even there were holding their hands over their ears. But Sibelius was hanging over the machine itself and trying to get more and more tone out of it. I said, you have the same kind of feeling about this sort of thing that I do. He said, oh yes, I want to hear everything. I want to hear every little note. I want to hear every semi-quaver. I said, well, you're hearing it all right. No doubt about that. Now, what is his position in music? He is a northern composer, and probably is the most complete northern composer that has appeared on the scene. He has the most original outlook. Whatever he has done at any time has always borne a stamp of complete individuality, almost isolation. I don't mean to suggest that you can't trace in his music influences, and sometimes the ancestry of quite a lot of his music. But nonetheless, it is highly individual all the time. And he is essentially, and this is a much abused word today, a romantic composer. He was born in the middle of the last century. He was born in the same period of 5 years as Richard Strauss, Frederick Delius, almost in the same period, Elgar, and just a little before Debussy. Quite a good vintage, I should say. And they all have the same characteristics. They have the same outlook. It is the romantic outlook. And I must say, as I was born not so very much later, I am not only entirely sympathetic with it, but I think it is this contribution of European music that in many respects is its main glory. Of course, there were spectacular figures, were Wagner and Berlioz. And the men I have mentioned will go down to posterity. And among them, most certainly, and beyond any doubt, standing out in some respects, apart from and beyond the others, but not in all respects, but some, is the honored name of Jan Sibelius.
Of the world of music that I knew as a boy and as a young man, practically nothing is left today as it was. One might say it has changed. It's only because I have a grain of optimism in me that will keep breaking through
as Dr. Johnson said, of some cheerfulness kept breaking through in spite of the man being a pessimist. I trusted that the next 200 or 300 years the great art of music may revive again. It's hardly necessary for me to emphasize that at the moment it is completely dead. Well, now, to show you the picture in its entirety, in its evolution, in its development, and its progress downward, from the top to the bottom, you know, and facetis descensus, as Virgil said, I will begin with the state of music in Europe 65 years ago, or 70 years ago, when I was a boy. It was exceedingly flourishing. And musicians, in spite of whatever you may have read about them, had a very good time. We lived in a paradise of inventive genius. I have said this before elsewhere, but I will say it again, that hardly a month went by in the 80s and the 90s, hardly a month went by without some masterpiece being generated in that world of music. Whether it was an opera of Mussorgsky or Borodin, or Rimsky-Korsakov, or Massenet, Saint-Saëns, or even Gounod and others, we had a marvelous succession of operatic masterpieces. This extended a little into the 19th century, when Puccini succeeded Verdi, and when we had in the Opéra Comique in Paris such extraordinarily original works as Pelléas and Mélisande and Louise, etc. We interest you to know that no one in any country has written a good tune for over 30 years. Think of it. You, if you profess to love music, if you will profess to practice it or cherish it, how do you do so? You can only do so by remembering what has been done in music and what is likable or lovable or admirable. And how do you remember what is likable, lovable, and admirable? By recalling the melodies written by great composers. You recall the melodies of Bach, of Handel, the operas of Mozart, scores of splendid tunes, the songs of Schubert, of Schumann, the tunes of Haydn and Mozart and Brahms and Dvorak and others. You remember the melodies, and they haunt your minds and memories. You think of them in the morning, you get up, and you recall them to yourselves when you go to bed at night. That is cherishing music. Now then, how much music written in the last 30 years are you able to cherish and go to bed with? I have on many occasions in mixed communities invited anyone present to get up on a chair or a table and sing to me any song written in the last 25 years. And no one's been able to respond to the invitation because they could not remember the tune. I'm sure almost all of you here can get up on a chair or a table and sing at least half a dozen songs of Mozart from beginning to end. I'd be very pleased to accompany you if you would. Or Schubert, without the slightest difficulty. But nobody can sing a modern song. Memory. They've got to see it. Then they can hardly believe it. Like the old story of the farmer in England, you know, who went to the zoo and for the first time saw the giraffe. He looked at it for 25 minutes
Then he was heard to say as he turned away slowly, I don't believe it. Now then, I've called it the changing world of music. Changing world. From my point of view, it's not the same world at all. It was something like heaven 60 years ago. And I won't go so far as to suggest it's the precise antipodes. This moment. But it's going there rapidly.
You might be informed that I've just had a birthday. I won't tell you how old I am, because I don't feel that age, and I never will. But a very agreeable event has taken place in connection with it, and that is a lunch party given to me by members of all the orchestras in Great Britain. That includes the five or six in London, and the others are from Birmingham, Manchester, Liverpool, and so on. And they are all players who at some time or other have appeared in one or other of the orchestras which I have had. Some are of advanced age, like myself. And some of them have sons who are playing for me. And others even have grandsons who are playing for me. In fact, my first orchestra was formed exactly 53 years ago. Now, that's a record for you, isn't it? When I founded six of them, and even the United States, two. That's not such bad going, is it? Well, naturally, I shall look forward to meeting these gentlemen again. And as they all be gathered together, I shall not lose the opportunity of telling them, frankly, just what I think about them all.